Y'all remember Ken Levine? That is a name that many gaming enthusiasts will be familiar with, Mr. Bioshock himself. His last project, you may recall, was Bioshock Infinite, which came out back in March of 2013. Since then, we have really not heard much from him, and a lot of people have been wondering what he's been up to. Well, he did establish a new studio, and he's been working on a game, but it's nowhere to be seen. And turns out there's a good reason why, based on the latest report from Bloomberg's Jason Schreier, who did an investigative report on what's been going on behind the scenes at that studio, and it's not good. Turns out Ken Levine, while he has lofty ambitions, is not good when it comes to management, when it comes to how he treats the employees, and it's led to a lot of burnout, it's led to a lot of delays, a lot of folks leaving, and both former and current employees spoke to Jason Schreier to detail the development hell that the next video game from Bioshock's creator has been in. Ken Levine's highly anticipated project was supposed to be out in 2017. People who worked on it explain how things went awry. So I'd like to scroll through the important bits of this article and comment along the way. It is noted that Ken Levine's new game following Bioshock Infinite's launch on 2013 has been in development for nearly 8 years. That stretch of a development cycle is certainly not normal, especially for an indie studio. So development for this project started in 2014. Prior to that, he worked on the 1999 release of the seminal System Shock 2, then came Bioshock in 2007, then came Bioshock Infinite in 2013, and then the project after that was supposed to be out in 2017. It is 2022 now, and seemingly there's still ways to go, according to 15 current and former employees of his new studio titled Ghost Story Games, whereas his previous studio was Irrational Games, you may recall. That was the development studio behind Bioshock. That was since closed down, and he established a smaller studio, Ghost Story, but that has not been going well due to his flawed management style that has resulted in a leadership where Ken Levine is often struggling to communicate his vision and alienating or browbeating subordinates who challenge him or fail to meet his expectations, say current and former employees. And this is a man also known for his stubbornness to the point that employees joke about something called Kenception, basically trying to, I guess, manipulate him to think that an idea that they had is actually his idea, so he thinks it's a good idea, because if he thinks it's coming from somebody else, it's very hard to convince him to, I don't know, change his mind about something or to just take feedback from his peers. It is then detailed how he's had a 15-year-long marriage, essentially, with Take-Two, a very close partnership, especially due to the success of Bioshock that really skyrocketed him as a game developer. And his success has given Take-Two the confidence to give Ken Levine a level of autonomy that is afforded to few game designers. And this would be great if Ken Levine were a good manager, but in his case, according to former employees, this has all been detrimental to their work and mental well-being. Bloomberg sources believe that he needs some form of oversight, somebody to keep him in check, because while he is an ambitious auteur, he doesn't always know how to execute from a managerial standpoint, and there needs to be someone just telling him, all right, enough is enough, you need to do X, Y, and Z, instead of just kind of letting him run rampant with just the level of perfectionism that disrupts a game development environment where certain deadlines need to be met, certain goals need to happen by a certain day, lest this project be stuck in development hell forever. Bloomberg notes that Levine's managerial style has led to burnout, caused a lot of pain, and the reason behind this is particularly highlighted when you look at a 2013 interview with website Grantland, when he said, if it's not right, it goes. The most experienced developers at Irrational tend to be the most comfortable with throwing stuff away, basically taking weeks or months of work, and if it's not to Ken Levine's standards or to his creative preferences, then completely getting rid of all of that. And look, every once in a while, something like that might happen during game development where you thought a concept was a good idea, but in execution, it didn't turn out to be such a great idea, and so that might be tossed out. But when it happens frequently, over and over again, that just signifies a lack of a clear vision, someone who's just kind of throwing darts everywhere until it eventually hits the bullseye, which is just not a good way to develop games. You need to have a very clear idea for what you want to do and just kind of go for it and make sound decisions, solid decisions, instead of swaying left and right, instead of being that rabbit who, you know, doesn't finish one carrot before going to the other. And somebody who feels the same way is a major part of Ken Levine's new studio, Mike Snyte, who Levine handpicked from Irrational to help start Ghost Story in 2014. He just straight up acknowledges right here that Ken is a very hard person to work for. And this can in large part be attributed to how ambitious Ken is with his endeavors, with his new studio Ghost Story setting out to revolutionize video game storytelling. A term that he would throw around a lot is the concept of narrative Lego, where instead of narratives being established by the game developers and taking players in an exact narrative path, it allows the players to shape the narrative based on their decisions and the reactivity of the game. That's a goal that he tried to pursue, but his managerial style and his stubbornness on certain aspects has led to his game being caught in development hell, while other titles like Wildermyth recently came out, which kind of have realized this idea of narrative Legos in a more timely fashion per Polygon's report here. Narrative Legos combine to make something astonishing. There's something about the player's agency in the narrative that has really caught a lot of people's attention. That's something that Ken Levine tried to be first to by 2017, which was when his current project was supposed to launch, but his managerial style led to delay after delay after delay, and eventually people couldn't take it anymore. While there are signs that finally the game is on track and estimated to release in maybe 2 years, you never know for sure, and we're still talking about a decade-long development cycle, and this has burned a lot of people out, including Snyte, who eventually quit, along with half of the original team. He says Levine's creative process is what drove him to leave after 5 years there, and he was quoted saying, "When it continuously goes in cycles and you don't align anymore, you kind of get tired of being part of that. I wasn't really happy anymore." The article then details the unfortunate way in which Irrational Games was dissolved. On February 18th, 2014, Ken Levine gathered the Irrational staff in the kitchen, and that's when he relayed to them, without any really prior warning, that he was shutting down the studio and laying off almost the entire staff. This was an unexpected and abrupt announcement. Keep in mind that this was a studio that Take-Two had bought back in 2006 and had seen great success since, with Bioshock Infinite having sold more than 6 million copies. So of course, a lot of employees were confused as to why this was happening when they thought Irrational was in a really good place. Well, Levine explained that the development of Bioshock Infinite had drained him and that the company had grown too large, so he wanted to explore new ideas with a smaller team and essentially start over. Now, he had chosen 11 employees of Irrational who he would inform about the plan because he asked them to come over to his new studio, but those 11 had to keep that secret, knowing their friends would soon be out of a job. Ken Levine essentially swore them to secrecy as he wanted to find the right time to relay the bad news, but this led to a lot of these developers who were chosen by Levine to feel a lot of survivor's guilt that led them to taking a break. "We didn't come into the studio for a while because they just felt so guilty that they were chosen, while all of the other employees were let go without much of a warning." But for those who did survive, Levine promised that this new studio would offer the financial stability of a major publisher and the agility and artistic freedom of an indie developer, all while setting the studio's sight on this concept of the narrative Lego that would involve the narrative thrusting players into different scenarios every time they played. It almost sounds like a roguelike, except the rogue elements don't deal in the gameplay, but rather in the narrative aspect of things. Sounds like a cool concept if it can be executed, but that's where the issues resided. Again, the idea was to release this game by fall of 2017. It was meant to be a sci-fi shooter like Bioshock set on a mysterious space station inhabited by three factions. Sounds more like System Shock, but you get the idea, very much up his alley. But the problem was that Levine set his goals impossibly high for the amount of manpower and resources that he had. He wanted to make a game as ambitious as Bioshock with a fraction of the staff. And so a lot of the employees wondered how they'd finish it with fewer than 30 people on the team, especially given the complicated dialogue system as part of this narrative Legos concept that required tons of writing that couldn't possibly be completed within a year. Here's how a former employee put it to Bloomberg: "The ideas and ambitions were great, but the scope just grew and grew without concern for the team's ability to get it done by our fall 2017 deadline. Ken wanted to make a AAA game with a budget team size. It was never going to happen. He was asking for the impossible." And this really emphasizes how, you know, the ground floor development developers are doing what they can in the circumstances that they're being given, but it's the decision makers and the creative directors who ultimately can decide the scope of a game and the time frame by which a game needs to be finished. And that's why you get results like Cyberpunk 2077, where the developers were not given enough time. Ken Levine is trying to give this project as much time as possible, but if the poor management continues, then this game will just be in development hell forever. And that's sort of on the opposite end of the spectrum, but equally bad of a circumstance. Ken Levine being too much of a perfectionist is highlighted here. One constant on Levine's projects is that he never seems content, because he was taught that you should just keep rewriting until everything was perfect. This was when he studied drama and he also wanted to be a screenwriter before getting into games. So that was the mindset that he had. But developing a game isn't like developing a movie. Even with movies, you know, doing reshots because the script change or whatever, like that can be costly and can delay things. But with game development, it can be that much worse, because so many systems rely on the established systems, and if you change one thing, it means you might have to change everything else, and that stuff kind of really trickles down in game development. So Ken Levine having this mindset of just tossing things away constantly and rechanging things constantly, it was just extremely disruptive, and it led to many, many delays with this project. As relayed by Bloomberg here, in Levine's interpretation, altruism has meant discarding months of work, much to his staff's dismay. At one point, he actually bragged about how in Bioshock Infinite, the team probably cut two games worth of stuff. And while Bioshock Infinite ended up being a pretty great game, that's not a good way to make a game. At least back then, Ken Levine had the manpower and resources to realize his ambitions, because Irrational was a much bigger studio, but he decided to go indie. That was his decision to go smaller, but his leadership didn't adapt to that, and he pretended like he was still running a AAA studio where he had infinite manpower and resources to realize every ambition he had, when no, you had to consider that you're now working with 30 or so people and you had to scale your projects appropriately. That was just not something he could do. Bloomberg also noted how in a panel a few years back, Levine explained the final act of his process. You sort of dick around for years and then you're like, oh my God, we're almost out of time, and it forces you to make these decisions. That sounds like the Anthem way of developing a project. Recall that BioWare was in pre-production for most of the 6-year-long development cycle because the decision makers, the creative heads, just were not good at reaching consensus for the direction of the game. And because the game was so directionless, it led to only a year and a half of that 6 years actually being spent on building the game. The rest of that time was spent coming up with ideas, scrapping them, throwing away, and then kind of rebooting the project in terms of its direction. And that's why Anthem turned out the way it did. Eventually, EA just had to push it out. Levine, at least, seems like he's trying to give this game all the time it needs, but it leads to the sensation that time never seems to run out at the new studio. Ghost Story employees spent weeks or months building components of the new game, only for Levine to scrap them. Levine's tastes occasionally change after playing a hot indie release, insisted some features be overhauled to emulate those games. Former staff say the constant changes were demoralizing and felt like a hindrance to their careers. Keep in mind that these are people who are trying to output something in a timely fashion so that they can show off their work to other prospective employers. Artists, in particular, are forbidden from including assets in their portfolios until a game is unveiled publicly, and Ken Levine's game hasn't been unveiled yet, so they cannot show any of their work that they've done in the past few years. And that very much hinders the ability to show just how much they've grown as a developer, again, for prospective employers down the line. And beyond that, because they're not shipping anything, it's demoralizing, it's creatively unfulfilling, and it feels like they're just gonna be stuck with a project that's in development hell forever. That's the sensation that they get. And they just cannot get the satisfaction of actually showing people what they've been working on, because this project keeps getting delayed because of Ken Levine's creative stubbornness. It's a game whose target went from 2017 to 2018, then 2019, and now, I mean, who knows? I mean, it's 2022, still nothing on the game. Now, one good thing that came from it is that this lax approach to deadlines minimized crunch time, and that's fantastic, but it still doesn't feel great to work on something that feels like it's gonna be eternally trapped, never to be released out there for an audience to creatively fulfill. These artists who want people to play their game. Working on a game with no clear release date is a challenge of its own. Bloomberg's article showcases a chart here that highlights just how much longer Ghost Story's new game, Ken Levine's new game, has taken compared to even some of the loftiest AAA titles. Obviously, System Shock 2 is an older title, only took 1.5 years to make. Bioshock went really ambitious with it, especially given it was released in the HD era. That took 5 years. Bioshock Infinite took 5 years. And then we've got other projects like Halo Infinite, which was a troubled project, but took 6 years. Red Dead Redemption 2 was, I mean, given how much attention to detail this game received and how much crunch was involved in it, it was a 7-year-long development cycle. Ghost Story, which should have been out 5 years ago back in 2017, has been in development 7.5 years, 8 years, and counting, with developers expecting this game will be out in roughly 2 years. And beyond Ken Levine asking for the impossible with the timetable of this game's development, what he wanted to do with this game just was also impossible to realize. One area where things clashed is that he wanted to make this narrative Lego concept, but he also wanted to make every scene in the game very cinematic. But achieving a level of cinematography that you get out of carefully curated stories with a very specific linear story, it's just a lot more difficult, if not nigh impossible, with this narrative Lego concept whose narrative is constantly adapting to the player's actions. It cannot be to the fidelity of something like Last of Us Part 2, where everything, every minute detail can be scrutinized because they have a very specific story to tell. And so this conflict of what Ken Levine wanted to make, this narrative Lego concept, and how he's used to directing very cinematically and fine-tuning every cutscene, him wanting to fine-tune every single way a story can unfold, despite it almost being a roguelike narrative, a narrative Lego, has led to just a lot of disruptions due to the impossibility of the task, at least for a team of this size and scale. The way a founding member of Ken Levine's new studio put it, who has since left the company, was that the type of game being explored does not match well with the creative process being used. And then add on top of that Ken Levine's tendency to throw months worth of work away. Levine often assessed aspects of the game when they were not yet finished, decide they weren't good enough, and command the team to scrap or change them. And you've got a situation where Ken Levine is giving this game all the time it needs, but it's also a game that just cannot be finished in a timely fashion because its ambitions far outweigh the studio's capabilities right now. And the cherry on top is that he isn't always pleasant to work with, described as having a mercurial demeanor that caused a lot of strife, just a very volatile man where one day he's very charming and welcoming, and another day when he's stressed out, he can become moody and lash out, single out an individual while berating them in front of their co-workers. And these clashes between the ground floor developers and Ken Levine eventually escalated enough that there were some who were let go, others simply quit. The studio's top producer resigned in 2017 following clashes with Levine. And now, I don't know how things are in 2022, but I hope they're course correcting. Sources did say that now they're on track to ship in like 2 years, so 2024, which is still so far away. And it is still, you know, with this project having started in 2014, again, it is straight up 10 years. Clearly something went very wrong behind the scenes, and Ken Levine, based on this report, largely contributed with his poor managerial style and with his inability to kind of take himself back a notch without Overwatch to keep him in check and give him realistic goals. Bloomberg's article summarizes this in its last paragraph as follows. Ghost Story was intended to be a friendlier, more supportive environment than its predecessor, but the studio was haunted by Levine's old ways of doing things. Intentions are one thing and reality is another, Gonzalez says. Indeed, that's why it's important to keep ambitions in check and to have a very clear vision for your project that matches with the resources and manpower that you have, with what is realistically possible, and that's something that Ken Levine struggles with. This is all in stark contrast to another quote-unquote auteur of the video games industry, Hideo Kojima, who with Death Stranding, it only took him 4 years from 2015 to 2019 to develop the full game and ship it, and this was during a time when he was ousted from Konami and basically had to start from scratch, including establishing his own development studio and finding a headquarters to build the game in. And that's because Say what you want about Kojima, but he always knows exactly what he wants out of a game, and he is realistic enough with his goals that he's able to ship a game within relatively reasonable time frame. Because Kojima starts with the idea first and solidifying those ideas before executing on them, he doesn't need to scrap a bunch of stuff along the way. I'm not saying nothing was scrapped when it comes to ideas for Death Stranding, but certainly not to the degree where it left that game in development hell. Death Stranding shipped quite quickly for this indie studio who essentially went on and created a full-on AAA game and, you know, had the backing of PlayStation. Certainly that helped with matters, but Ken Levine has the backing of Take-Two, but it's just his managerial style that's really getting in the way of this game's development. And hopefully in the recent years, he's kind of learned from his mistakes and will be able to ship this game. And hopefully this is something that he won't repeat. But for now, yeah, this is pretty discouraging to hear, given that I really do enjoy Ken Levine's work, from System Shock to Bioshock. You know, he's put some really great stuff out there, and I have little doubt that the ambitions surrounding his new game are really exciting, but a game being caught in development hell is just not something encouraging, especially when so many employees and developers feel like they haven't been treated very well, or that the promise of an indie studio-like flexibility and autonomy with the backing of a AAA institution, like, that promise just doesn't feel like it's been fulfilled for them. A lot of people just burned out, said enough of this, and left, and Ken Levine has to adapt or just be stuck in development hell for the foreseeable future. And let's hope that, you know, Ken will see this article and realize that, you know, he has to course correct, and hopefully that will lead to positive change. But until we hear more about this game, let me know in the comments below what your thoughts and opinions are on the latest report surrounding Ken Levine and his studio Ghost Story and the development hell that their game has been in currently. And to be further updated on all things gaming news, reviews, and discussions, stay tuned right here on Yong. Yeah, I'll see you guys next time. Yong out.